I created a 6 meter tall sculpture at the Global Plastic Treaty Negotiations, which features a sculptural remix of Rodin's The Thinker, crushed plastic bottles in one hand, little baby in the other, sitting on top of a sculpture of Mother Earth with a giant strand of DNA wrapped around both of them. And each and every day that goes by, we're gonna bury the installation slowly but surely with more and more plastic.
Can we get agreement? Yes. Will it be easy? No. Is there a pathway? Yes.
Right.
This is why this work matters, because you're just very simply and very in a very sophisticated way telling the story of get the job done already.
We need to get the job
we
done.
Need to
yeah,
get
absolutely.
The job done.
We know that there are 16,000 chemicals that are used or present in plastics products. And these can lead to impacts in human health. More than 4,200 of those chemicals are known to have hazardous properties. This includes their being cancerogenic, they're impacting our metabolism, leading to obesity and diabetes, and impacting our reproductive health. There are more than 10,000 chemicals that we lack data on and can't properly assess. Science tells us that we need to reduce plastics production. We are making too much plastics. Our societies can't manage it. Our planet can't tolerate it.
This problem isn't going away. It's only gonna get worse. It's only gonna get harder. And it's gonna be someone else. Our kids, our grandkids, they're gonna be the ones that are gonna have to figure this out. And so this problem right here is our burden to bear. And we need to do everything that we possibly can.
It's very difficult to imagine all of the uses that will be made of quantum technologies. And it's not just quantum computers, but quantum sensors and quantum networks and communication and so on. But all of this is going to require a lot of different skills. And so right now there is a lack or a shortage of people who are equipped to go into and qualified to go into these fields. There are certainly technologies that will need to be advanced, and that means hardware and software and the components that go into the hardware and so on. But it also is going to require a lot of people with new skills. It's going to take the end users to adopt these technologies. So there's a lot of educating to be done on the part of the customers, if you will, or the people who are going to benefit from it. So our study showed that there were sort of three groupings of skills. One was hardware, and those sort of hands-on in the lab skills. One was software, different set of skills needed for that. You're going into a company, and the small companies and startups, of course, generally are founded by people who have very little business skills or communications and marketing skills or sales skills. And so there's a real need for people with those kinds of skills and maybe just a little bit of quantum understanding. The skills that were being sought didn't sort of say quantum physics or have quantum in the title. So again, it was somewhat traditional STEM disciplines that were being looked for. And the degree that was preferred was not a PhD in general. It was perhaps a college degree or a master's degree. In some cases, even less than that was required for someone who was going to be doing technical work, would get some education perhaps on the job. So if someone is able to do an internship or a summer job or get some experience where they're actually working in a lab environment, even if it's not with quantum technology, they have a real advantage. Because so many students have a lot of what you would call maybe book learning and theoretical understanding, but they don't have any hands-on experience. So I would highly encourage students to look for opportunities to work in a laboratory, whether it's at a university or at a company. Just a little bit of hands-on experience would go a long way.
So we connect business with customers. By the end of the day, the customers can pre-order magic bag on our platform. When they open the app, they see a list of stores where they can get a magic bag. So it's more like a mystery box. And then they pre-order on the app, and then the customer go to the store and pick it up. So one thing is they get a much lower price to buy food, and then they also get surprised by opening the box, and together we reduce food waste. We attract a lot of young customers using this application, and when they open the box, because you don't know what's going to be wasted by the end of the day, so it's a surprise bag. And when people get it, they take pictures and they post it online on social media, like Red Note, WeChat, the Chinese social media. And then it gets viral, and people get the idea of how they can reduce food waste by reducing their personal cost and also opening a surprise bag in their daily life. In China, there was no solution like reducing food waste at the consumer side. So at that time, as a normal consumer, I really want something in my life as a life option, so I can like do something small every day and help to save food and contribute a little to saving the planet.